Well, standard. Get together, you know. Halifax is.
The Western Front. And it changed his thinking tremendously. It was the reality of war was just searing. A quick digression on that, some remark that the First World War was a turning point in history, not only for the number of people that were in it, but it happened at a particular moment in history. Many national boundaries, national organizations and so on, were outmoded. They had to change. It was merely a matter of time. And social mores and so on were all paying tribute to Christian values, but World War I made it clear that this was a facade. There was a tremendous amount of cynicism after World War I because it was obvious that it was hollow. And of course is what set the scene for Russia, because in 1917 you had the biggest turnabout in history, when a great Christian nation had a revolution just with less than 5% of its population, and they won, and they resorted to terrible cruelty. They executed the Tsar and his family, and they stood up before the world and said, "We don't believe in God. All we believe in is a materialist philosophy. There is no such a thing as soul or spirit." And so this was monstrous. Even people who weren't living up to it, they had never expected such a challenge as this. The philosophers tell us that in the writings of Kant, their main theorist, he is so powerful a thinker, the whole theory of materialism was so tight. If you miss the flaw in the first 30 or 40 pages, you've had it. You have to go all the way. Now that didn't mean that it was true, but one of the greatest tests of truth is coherence, unity. If you pick it up and from no matter what angle you get, if it always rings the same, it's probably true. And so communism, in fact, stood up and said, Christianity, Chesterton said it, many of you know Chesterton, the wonderful Christian essayist in England, died in 1937. He said, Christianity has not failed, it has never been tried. It never really was taken up and lived. But communism said, Christians, on guard, I think it was Lenin who said that, you obviously don't intend to go everywhere with what you're talking about. We do intend. And the world has been dominated for 80 or 90 years, by that doctrine. And the disillusioned people of Europe and the United States were fooled by it for a while. Many of them went after the communist doctrine and swallowed it. But in any event, this is the kind of world that that was beginning. When they went to the Treaty of Versailles, they had decided Germany was the culprit, and it would have to pay the bills. And they realigned, they drew new national boundaries all around Europe. And you have such names as Yugoslavia and Czechoslovakia, these compound names of stitching together. Before the war, the Austro-Hungarian Empire was the largest one in Europe. There were 57 languages spoken through it, and the emperor lived in Vienna, and it was a fitting capital for an empire that large. Among the things that the heads of nations did at Versailles was to take Austria, trim off all of its imperial possessions, cut the country itself down to about one-fifth of its size, and the great city of Vienna, the capital of it, was cut off from its sources, its the agriculture and the forestry and the farming and so on. It had no income. This was one of the places that Kelly went to visit. By now, extension had become well enough off. It had really succeeded that he had authority to go and help out. He went to Vienna and found people starving there in the midst of this elegance. The city of Vienna was the romantic capital of the world. Gemütlichkeit, the elegance, the last word in style, and people starving. So he was able to bring help there. Some years later, this is one of the countries that decorated Kelly for his work there, and Spain also decorated for because of work that I'm going to mention in a few minutes. Because they regarded, they had picked Germany as the scapegoat, they were going to penalize it. Germany, like several other countries, had a big empire out in Asia and some places down in Africa. And so she was going to be stripped of that. German influence was to be rooted out anywhere that it could go. Among other things, the Christian missionaries would have to be curbed in, and particularly Germany, which had the finest missionaries in the world, trained, and they had depth and experience. And this was the only lead that Kelly would need, Carpe Diem. He rushed over to lobby in Versailles at the great Paris conference, the peace conference, preparing the Treaty of Versailles. And he was trying to save the German missions. And it wasn't a very popular kind of fight to be conducting, but he went not really authorized by, let's say, the American government or by all the bishops, but they were used to see him, running about, and he usually was he was on the trail of the vital things most of the time. So here, among other things, he did actually succeed in getting one of the articles of the Treaty of Versailles wiped out, the one that would have dispelled or dismissed German missionaries from anywhere it found them. I must move on to another question there. The looming question, we'll need a few minutes, was a big one hanging there. We remember that all during from the 17th century on, there was a gradual breakdown of aristocracy, of class society, a move toward people's participation in government, independence. And as time went on, you had broken away from the great unity that had been Christendom. There was a kind of unity that they called Europe, but the nations within it were feeling their oats. They were insisting on trying to salvage any independence they could have. And of course it came to a head. The Americans, who had come together from all over the world, had their great war of independence, and finally won it. It didn't last that long, but they won in 1775. And the French were right over there helping them. So not long after that, the French had their showdown with the nobility. And the peasants, and the not so much the peasants, the faith was there, it was the ordinary people of the cities. In any event, there was terrible violence and carnage, particularly the church and nobility, martyred, really. The guillotine was, the knocking heads off 100 a day in the year. And that wave of independence was sweeping across Europe, and it came to Italy after Napoleon's victories. He had swept across Europe and had imposed his own control, but and eventually he loses in 1815. But the wave of independence came to Italy, and let's say around 1850, and over several centuries, the Pope in Rome was a spiritual ruler, but many times he had done a service back from the times of the Holy Roman Empire. He had arbitrated, or sometimes they even went in and fought. But they were granted the pieces of land, the papacy. So that across the middle of the peninsula of Italy, you had the papal states ruled by the Pope and bishops. And the most alarming thing, of course, was Rome itself. The ruler of the city of Rome was the Pope. If you go there and look at the monuments, inscriptions all over the place, this was erected by order of Pope so-and-so, and fountains and parks and so on. So they panicked. At the end of the 4th century, they panicked when the Vandals were coming to take over pagan Rome. The thought of the fall of Rome was about the same as a nuclear holocaust today. If Rome can fall, what is safe? So at any rate, there was an international brigade gathered to come and defend the Pope. It didn't work anyway. Kapoor and his other associates won. They conquered Rome and swept up the peninsula. And the Pope at the time, this is around 1867. Matter of fact, we had an islander over there studying at the propaganda at that time. He wanted to go out and fight, but they told him to stay home and study. He was Cornelius O'Brien. An uncle of Father Terry Campbell, a brilliant man. In any event, the Pope, in protest, marked off a section of Rome across the Tiber River and built 40-foot massive walls, retired behind it, and announced he would stay there until this injustice was regulated. Nothing happened, and it went on through the first kingdom of Victor Emmanuel and others, and on through World War I. And Versailles did nothing about it. But when Kelly was there in doing his lobbying, he met some people who were very knowledgeable, and they said, the churchmen who said that something had to be done, the time was getting ripe. So he happened to meet a couple of these and seized on it, on their words, and then got in contact with Cardinal Gasparri, the Secretary of State down in Rome, and contacts were made with Orlando, who was the president of Italy at the time, and Orlando was very interested. Something could be done. At the end of the war, nothing did happen. Orlando died, actually, I think around 1920. And in 1922, Mussolini came in, and it was Mussolini in 1929 who negotiated with Rome, and you had the Lateran Concordat, which solved the Roman question, that the Vatican was set up as an independent state. It's a country on its own, about a mile square. And with some extraterritorial possessions outside, and heavy financial indemnities, and so on. But another part of Kelly's involvement, it wasn't always appreciated at home, that part of it, but. in between Versailles and the Lateran Pact, Kelly was named a bishop in 1924, Bishop of Oklahoma, and it was a missionary diocese. Oklahoma had just been declared a state around 1902 or 3, and so it was pretty wild country still at that time, and so well, this is a picture of a collaborator of Kelly in the Extension magazine, and Father later Bishop O'Brien, and. Especially forget about the Tampa shot. We have a picture here of the the consecration of Kali. You can see him in the white vestments, and on his right, another islander, Bishop Archbishop Alfie Sinnott of Winnipeg, born actually in Crapo, but related to Sinnott on the island here. And then Cardinal Mundelein, Archbishop at the time, later Cardinal, and Archbishop Leopoldo Ruiz. That's reminiscent of the thing we won't have time to talk about. Down in Mexico, which has a Catholic population at the beginning of about 95%, but it had gone through a century easily of terrible things, the 19th century, and it had gone through a communist phase. Trotsky was killed there, wasn't he? Kelly had an in with the Mexican bishops, and they were driven out under Carranza, who was supposed to be Catholic, but he banned Catholic schools, and there was bloodshed. There were violent things. Many bishops and priests and religious were killed, and Kelly called for intervention by the United States, but they were not really interested in the matter of principle. They were weighing the possibilities of trade with this rich country, rich resources. The Mexican hierarchy had to go into exile, and they picked Kelly as their contact with the American government. You can see the various ways. I am going to have to draw this to a close here. He has been riding a wave up until this time. He survives, he's ordained, he becomes a bishop in 1924. He is in active control of it until 1944, and he dies in 47. He is sort of burnt out and disillusioned. He had hoped, really, there was a lot of ambition really there, as there was in many churchmen who had probably deep faith and good intentions, but not without ambition. So the work of extension continued to grow. Kelly, meanwhile, was writing. Amid all of this, up to 1939 or 40, he wrote about 25 books that had quite a vogue. Some of them were short stories. He's a master storyteller. His lifestyle was affected by this even. He would stay up till 2 o'clock in the morning, concentrating on these things. He's a craftsman with language, and he saw that he was starting to be moved out of the power circle, and felt bitter about it. But in 1936, he was still doing this kind of thing. He came to Charlottetown and preached a retreat for the diocesan clergy over at the college, and he still had his sister Catherine married a Hughes, and the Hugheses are nephews and nieces of the bishop. Another sister, Lucy, married Clarkin, and she was a poet herself. Lucy Gertrude Clarkin, who wrote some very lovely poetry. She had the gift too. I've always felt really that the Hennessy way with language was from the same genes. I think it's not accidental. However, the fire was not completely gone. He had one more field that he moved into: education. He saw that people were leaving Oklahoma. And around 1928, they discovered oil there, and that made for a boom, but not necessarily for a great boom in spirituality or religion. It became more and more materialistic. But he had a wonderful gift of charming people, and we had some pictures of the contacts he had with old characters like Alfalfa Bill Murray and Phillips, who was the that's an interesting one. He's still acquainted with people at the top, and chief captain of the Navy. In any event, he does get involved, and there he is with the governor. It amuses me. It looks as if he's saying, what does one do with the things like this? Rolling ball. He's not an aficionado. There's Alfalfa Bill. He's a thorny character, but deep down a very dependable man. By the way, we have a number of priests who went down to Prince of Island, to Oklahoma from here, because of the Kelly connection. He has several Rumis and several two Macaulays from Surrey, and Father Oswald Murphy and Father Gavin Monaghan became Dowson Director of the Religious Education. Was dealing with a very, not hostile, but just a society, a government that had new prosperity and no particular urge to go for the finest things. His last big fight was in education, and many of the things of the past come back. He had a vision of the greater university. There were a couple of them in the States and some smaller colleges, and he wanted them all bound together in one structure with some autonomy in the different parts, but a basic core. And one of the powerful things he could use was a parallel that he knew about in Canada. When Toronto gathered together four universities in, around 1910 or 12, they arranged it that each component could teach four basic courses on its own campus. All the other courses belonged to the overall university. It was a pattern that worked very, very well and was copied across Canada and other places. And Kelly brought that and impressed people very much. He also could talk of the the two cultures and languages in Canada, because he had been through that himself. And so, so many things came together there. And his, I think it's almost time for us to, I'm going to close with a, if I can find my glasses. Oh yes, we had a picture there of H.L. Mencken, one of the most famous literary critics in the 20th century in the States. He belonged to Baltimore, and he was, is he there? Not known for great sympathy for religious people. He always called a spade a spade. But he and Kelly happened to be going to Europe on a liner one time, and there was not much other interesting company. They landed with one another and spent most of the voyage talking with one another. And he was a charmer, and so he became a very close friend, and gave his blessing to the many things that that Kelly wrote. All the way through his writing, behind all the lovely clever plots and the painting of character and so on, by the way, he was also not only knitting together Catholic ones, all through his career he had excellent relations with other churches and spoke very strongly in that, and many of his books were adopted, as a matter of fact. He wrote books on formation of young people or clergy, and they were often picked up by the other denominations and put in their seminaries. Yeah, it was so sound. Right to the end, Mencken was a very close friend of his. When Kelly died in 47, the Cardinal, Archbishop of Chicago, Samuel Cardinal Stritch, who also had done a stint at the head of Extension, wrote a very lovely article and told the story in about 7 paragraphs in very, very nice prose. At the end of it, he said the following: Bishop Kelly had rare gifts of intellect. He might have been a great figure in literature. There was in him something of the poet, something of the artist. But he had knelt long in meditation at the foot of the cross. The motto which he took for his life was love for love. His gifts he used in the service of his king. It was intolerable for him to think of writing or speaking without pointing his work to his life purpose. There may be some who will say that in him the promoter spoiled the artist and kept him always in the realm of the near great in literature. That's generally conceded to be a good principle. Art shouldn't be selling something. It has to be completely at the service of its vision. That's the way the theory goes. But some felt that he was in the realm of the near great. This criticism is not founded, Stritch says. Bishop Kelly was a romantic adventurer. You can believe that after what I've told you. Romantic, feelings, hunches, insights. A romantic adventurer, always engaged in the quest for souls, delightfully human, charmingly personal, beaming with friendship for all men, although learned, not a scholar, Bishop Kelly was one of those rare captains in the army of Christ who know how to reach into souls and make conquests for the King of Kings. Thank you. No, I never laid eyes on the man myself. Zarista Chandra did, I think.
Well, I'm not lucky enough to be Irish, but I'm lucky enough to have heard a sermon by Bishop Kelly.
Oh, my.
Now, it's not something.
Now we know the secret of his success.
As a non-Catholic, why that would happen. And I'll tell you why.
Yeah.
You know, Bishop Kelly and I were born 2 miles apart.
Exactly, yes.
Yeah. I was born in New Perth, and Bishop Kelly was born in Somerville. That's right.
Yeah.
He must have been born at his mother's place, Murphy in Somerville. But anyway, how did I hear a sermon by Bishop Kelly? I'll tell you. In 1928, at least, I think that was right, he was bishop then for 4 years, and he came back to the Vernon River Church one Sunday to visit. And it was in the paper that he was going to preach the sermon there that morning.
Yeah.
And my father, being a politician, and he heard that Bishop Kelly was a good speaker, he decided we should go up and hear him. So my brother had one car, and we went in the car and we went up to Vernon River, St. Dragon's Church there, and we heard Bishop Kelly preach the sermon. And you know, I can still remember the sermon, believe it or not. I've heard an awful lot of sermons since. Well, I don't remember a darn thing about them. But anyway, I remember Bishop Kelly speaking about the Church Universal. The Church Universal. And he described the Church Universal. And then he said, St. Joachim's Parish is a miniature of the Church Universal. And he proceeded to explain how that was. Now, it's a very remarkable thing.
Now, what was your question? Thank you very much, Dr.
Any other questions or comments?
Where did you get the name Clement?
Could well have been. It was a fairly common name. That's one of the early Christian saints. One of the popes, more than one of them, I think, was called Clement. We have a simple explanation of that. That's snobbery. I have almost given up myself on being named bishop, but...
Would you put a B in there?
I don't know.
So and I wonder, does it surprise you that Bishop Kelly had come from Canada, Prince Edward Island, the universities, and his place, that he was so well received, or was he so well received by the American hierarchy? And obviously, his success and his going to Versailles and going to whatever.
No. That's a good question. I think he himself may have sort of admitted that, but wondered if he was ever really fully received. But on the other hand, you know, he was admired. But at the end, he was really feeling neglected at the end of it. But I think.
Now he came back, his sermon, Church says, I think, overlapped with Bishop Sheen.
Oh, yes.
That was a good relationship, I think.
Oh, yes. Sheen admired him very much.
Yeah.
Cardinal O'Connor, who died not long ago in New York, said that Kelly was his hero when he was growing up. I don't know. He was never, I don't remember his being a great fighter for that. He was, but he, no, remember that was called the Sooner State.
Yes.
It was pretty wild, really. Particularly the way it's shaped is almost a square and a little handle out at the top, the panhandle, which is sort of drawn in because it didn't fit in with any other state. So it was really never well governed. It's a place for robbers and all that.
Mother Andrew Reed wrote a column, one of his columns of
Oh, yes.
He ended it something like, the man in the church forgot, and he said he failed there. There was a lot of he said
he quoted that thing of scripture, put not your trust in princes. And when he, at his funeral, a couple of his old friends, it wasn't as well attended as it should have been, and they remarked, put not your trust in princes. So if any of you get to be bishops or take a lesson, put not your trust in princes. Thank you very much. In Oklahoma. Yeah. Thank you very much. Just before we leave, a reminder for next week, John Cousins will be speaking on Fitzgerald, the schoolmaster up in West Prince, back in the middle 1800s. John, as you know, is always very interesting, and I'd be surprised if he doesn't throw in a song or two along with his lecture. Again, it's 7 o'clock next week, so spread the word to folks who may be interested in that, and don't have them showing up at the end of the lecture. Thank you all for coming. Thank you, Father Kelly, for your terrific lecture this evening, and we look forward to seeing you again. I should.
So feel free to stick around if you want. There's still some coffee, and if you want to chat it up, you're welcome to stay as long as you want.
Done by Monsignor Jim Gaffey,
in Santa Rosa, California, around 1982, I believe. And it's an excellent one. The, it's out of print, but that is one of the sources. It's an excellent piece of biography. The bishop himself wrote an autobiography that appeared in 1939, and it got high acclaim. It's available, there's a copy in the stacks, I think perhaps two copies at the UPEI, but these are sources that you can get. But he is a man who wrote a tremendous amount. He even preserved a lot of his, most of his personal correspondence. He edited a national monthly for almost 20 years. So there's a lot of print in which you can come to meet this man, Francis Clement Kelly. So some of you do know him, but I had the problem when I was asked to do this. I have to assume that most of you don't know his story. I have to begin with information. If you all knew about it, it could be a discussion about him, an evaluation, or an impact that he had here or there. But I've adopted this plan of running through his career, and in the last part of it, I'll do a little evaluating. But so this is why you might look at this from time to time. We have a little larger print over there, and from time to time I'll point to a particular date and remark about it. So I hope you know where we're going. I'm not all that sure myself, but so we're going to start with some pictures of his parents. He was born in Prince of Orange in 1870 in Lot 52. That's along the 48 Road, near where it meets the Stanhope Road. That's not the North Shore Stanhope. But his father, John Kelly, had a farm, and just two over, Andrew Murphy had another farm. And John Kelly married Andrew Murphy's daughter. It's through the Murphys that Mike Hennessy and his family are just as closely connected to the bishop as I am. Our mother, Kelly, we're all over the place. I might as well stop hiding it now. We were just about to pull off the coup, but we'll delay it a couple of years now. But then, our mother was, our mother's father and the bishop's father were brothers. My mother and he were first cousins. But then, this is Andrew Murphy then, who was the uncle of the bishop, and then we go on, I guess. This is his mother, Mary Ann Murphy. They're not weak faces by anything. Oh. And then you might as well give us a couple more, please. This has to do with his education. Jim Doyle School, I think that's on the town road. The building is not there now, but it was famous. Jim Doyle was a very fine teacher for several generations. Below, Dalton Hall was not there when the bishop attended St. Dunstan's. It was built just in 1919, But Old St. Dunstan's, that building was built in 1854 and later given a brick face on it. It was a wooden building to start with. So Francis Clement Kelly was born in Somerville in Vernon River Parish. When he was 8 years old, his family moved to Charlottetown. And the father was a very enterprising type. He was a real merchant at heart. They settled on Pleasant Street, up off of Monmouth Avenue. And Frank went to vague whether St. Patrick's School was still there or they had already changed its name to Queen Square. The biography calls it Queen Square School. And after that he went to St. Dunstan's when he was only 15 years old. But his father was a man of some note, and he was a merchant. He had at least a couple of shops for trading in farm goods, and also you'd almost call them public rooms. The people, there was a desperate amount of thirst around at that time, and through the goodness of his heart, he arranged to. But because he was in that business, Frank was able to claim in his autobiography that he even knew something about the sea, because his father shipped goods to Newfoundland. One summer he went across in a schooner, and there were three of the crew on it, and it was and they ran into some terribly foul weather. He nearly lost his life, and but lived to boast about it anyway. He was not bad at that, by the way. But the, in any event, because he had a flair for writing, we have a man here too that had a great influence on him. He called him the Prince of Teachers, Alexander Macaulay, who came from the island but did his studies up in Ottawa University, and was just a remarkable influence on the students at that time. He coached rugby, and he was an excellent lecturer. He went to the seminary and came back, and for many years he was a pastor here. He was an excellent theologian. He would run off an essay on some obscure point of theology and get it published in one of the journals. So he was, he had a great influence on Francis Kelly. Also, I think we might as well meet a couple of the bishops that he this is a man who was a bishop from 60 to 90, he had a great influence, and if you read the island history, he was engaged in a fair amount of the public discussions, and he built St. Dunstan's. He had been pastor up in Tignish, and then came down and built St. Dunstan's. And he did not build the rectory at the cathedral, but he probably had the dream. That's the kind of thing he would build. His successor, Bishop James MacDonald, built it around 1885 or something like that, I believe. But he was a very brave man, a very bright person, Bishop Peter MacIntyre. And then he was, Frank want to, after he was finishing 3 years at St. Dunstan's, which means he would have been around 18 or 19 years old, he felt the call to go to the priesthood, and he was sent off to a seminary in Chicoutimi. That it was standard for centuries, people prepared for the priesthood by going and living in the household of the bishop. So he was secretary to this man, Bishop James Rogers, who was a classmate of McIntyre in their seminary days. I think he may have been from Ireland, but I'm not sure of that. He was he, George? autobiography, the bishop jots it down, is the title of it. He describes the thrill that he had. This man was a great talker. Kelly would come out to serve his mass, perhaps at 8:30 in the morning, and the bishop would come into the small chapel and ask what feast it was and what should be put out. They might get down to having mass about 11:30. he went on and on. That brought something else to mind, and he covered heresies, and he covered arts and history and so on. So it was a real education, a marvelous one. The following year, he went to a second seminary. Father Elwa Arsenal, one of our present priests, studied there, and a number of Franco-Americans studied there too. I had classmates from there when I was studying in Quebec, but I never actually visited, but I would love to. Apparently it was landscaped beautifully and so on. Anyway, that had a huge influence on Kelly. He knew French quite well. He read French authors, and the classical ones, Bossuet and Lacordaire and people like that. And one of his novels is copied after reminiscent anyway of Jean-Jacques Rousseau. And so he had that in his arsenal of armor and so on. So we go from there to his first assignment. We had a little picture of the, oh, there he is, yeah. That's a picture of him. I think it might mean right after he was ordained, but we just call it the young cleric. The island was already overproducing religious sisters and clergy and shipping them out. They used to say priests and potatoes were the main exports. So he signed on for the Diocese of Detroit. And he was ordained a little before he finished his 23rd year. He was, that would not be allowed now by canon law, or it has to be very special permission, but to tell something about his ability. When he got to La Pierre, in his book he tells about Detroit itself, that is about 300,000 people, I think, at that time, but He was assigned to a place called La Pierre, which is a place of about 25,000 people, I believe. And when he got there, it was a very sad situation. The priest who was there had sort of blacked himself out. He was he had serious problems. Health, but frankly, matters of morality too. It was a great scandal, a terrible blow to the people in that parish. And young Kelly came in, 23 years old, and has to try to cope with this. Had never been a curate, an assistant. So he has to appeal to the people and so on. Well, that was the start of a special kind of career. He had discovered that he had real facility in language. He wrote well. He studied the English essayist when he was at St. Dunstan's, and he had good teachers in that. And so he he had a problem within the first, apart from the terribly sensitive one of credibility and so on, death was a terrible problem. The earlier building was going to pieces, and they had to start with this one, which was dedicated in 1901. But so he looked about for a way of earning some money on the side. He started one practice, broke it to go to the Spanish-American War, returned to the practice, and this practice was the following. It was before the time of electronic media, and how did people entertain themselves and divert themselves? Well, one of the most common ways was public lectures. Many people had a fine command of language, and if you study the literature of the time, it was a bit flowery and so on, but it was well constructed. And so he decided to try that, and there were lecture agencies that would take your name and describe your specialty. So he spent several winters on the lecture trail, and he went to practically every corner of the United States. It would be mainly small places that he visited, and he and I suppose the contact most often would be connected with the church, but it might not have been either in these places. Educated person that came along probably would be welcomed. So he it's important to mention this, because out of this experience is going to rise his first great achievement. He went off to the Spanish-American War, which started in 1898, and it was a matter of the United States intervening in the Spanish struggle with Cuba. Cuba was fighting for its independence, and the Spanish kingdom wanted to prevent it, and the United States, and I guess it was the Monroe Doctrine or one of those, that said that foreign nations were not to establish a base close to the United States. I don't know enough about the American history, but in any event, It was on this pretext that they fought, and they defeated the Spanish Navy, and the Spaniards went home, and the Americans had Puerto Rico as a protectorate, and the Philippines. A nice little byplay from a two-year war. It was Teddy Roosevelt that was the main character in the American army down there. Kelly, yes, we have him on horseback. He makes no bones about it, although he had started out in the firm. He wasn't sure which end of the horse you were to have pointing ahead. One time, as a matter of fact, the horse ran away with him, and it was a subject of a lot of embarrassment for a while. But he never got into action. I think he got over to Cuba at one point, but he never actually was in battle. And he returned, but right now we begin to see this man was no blushing little pansy. There's an expression that some people use a bit lately, I forget, one of the movies had it, carpe diem, which is a Roman expression, and it shows up in one of Horace's odes. Seize the day. Grab it, take hold of it. And that was very much the style of Francis Clement Kelly. He was not afraid to dash in and probably exceed his mandate in various areas. So he somehow near the end of his time before he mustered out, they needed to send a delegation up from the army to meet Roosevelt in Washington to discuss some point, and he was one of a group of three or four that was in there, that explaining the state of affairs and so on. He returned to up here, and he was distressed about what he had seen in the isolated, lonely places of the United States. It was there was no sense of mission among the people and of helping them out. So he contacted some prominent bishops, notably the Archbishop of Chicago, Archbishop Quigley, and this was a very practical kind of man. He wasn't a dreamer at all, but he was courageous, and he didn't mind encouraging someone with a dream, and he helped to launch Kelly's dream. What was the dream? That there'd be an effort on the part of the leadership of the Catholic Church in the United States to appeal to all the established places to go and help the suffering ones. And in order to get that done, he would need to persuade the hierarchy, the clergy, and interested laymen. So that activity is going to take up 3 or 4 years. We're talking now 1905, and I have to digress at this point to talk about a problem that would be connected with missions. It has to do with the structure of the Catholic Church. The Catholic Church borrowed a great deal of its form from the Roman Empire. The Romans, you'll remember, just before the incarnation, that focal point in human history, before it happened, the Romans had reached the peak of their power. They grew, it is true, extensively, but the height of their achievement really was about the year 31 BC. The Republic had produced citizen armies that were powerful enough to go out and overcome any armies they encountered, any native ones, any untrained armies. The Republic fell, and it was replaced by an absolute ruler, a principate, or emperor, as he came to be called shortly after. So the Roman state continued to extend, but really the spirit that had made it had been broken. It was no longer a proud nation of people who could debate and knew that their arguments would determine the decision. So the Romans overcame the Greeks, who any day at all could be more creative. They could outthink the Romans, they were blessed. They had all the things needed for great creativity down in the peninsulas at the end of the Mediterranean. But the Romans were no rivals with the Greeks there, but they spotted a good thing. They could recognize it and pick it up. Above all, the Romans had the finest sense, practical sense, in history, at least up to that point, and perhaps since. Their basic training in their homes and in their communities was based on discipline, hard, practical decisions. They had not been favored, as the Greeks were, by climate and nature generally, but the Romans knew how to make a thing happen. They knew how to organize. The Roman contribution to civilization is law. They have the highest sense of how to organize it. And so the British, later even modern empires, used to train their future leaders in Roman history. Go and study what Caesar and the other historians said, and study the rhetoric of oratory of Cicero, and the Christian religion was born at the highest moment of tranquility in the world up to that point, the Pax Romana. For some time, things were quiet. It wasn't necessarily peace. Tacitus, another historian, said, "Vastam faciunt pacem appellant." They make a waste and they call it peace. You know, if you've killed everybody, everything's nice and quiet. But that's not peace. But they, however, the Christian religion got started, but went underground until the beginning of the 4th century, when Constantine gave it permission and it came forth. And then, by that time, the Roman Empire in Italy and beyond was weakening. because of luxury and because of the pressure of barbarians who were around. But the Catholic Christian religion imitated the style of government and the way they organized society and so on. So the Romans understood when you went out and conquered new land, they had a nice term for that, they pacified new territories. Handy. So they were given a certain amount of self-determination, but it really was martial law at first. And then more participation, and they had to adopt Roman culture, and the working language was, for practical purposes, Latin, a kind of kitchen Latin that got more and more loose. But when a new territory gets stabilized, after a while it could have a fair amount of local government. It became a province. Or the, I'll not get off on it, actually anyone in the new treaty areas became actually citizens of the city of Rome, and that's the way it expanded. But then, so they had like a home office and a foreign office, and they had and the Catholic Church, as it expanded, imitated that. There was they had departments of government. Today we talk about ministries or departments. In Rome, they call them congregations, and the areas of government that have to do with perhaps doctrine, worship, authority, canon law, bishops, and so on. But among other things, the essence of the Christian religion really is mission. When they arrive, they say that we have been sent. We are not building something on our own. It is of the essence. They have been told something, and they are to share it with everybody. It's an order. Go and proclaim the gospel to the whole world, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have ordered you, and behold, I am with you to the end of the world. And so the missions are an important part of church government. The name, by the way, is interesting. It was a department, a congregation, De Propaganda Fidei, for the propagating of the faith. Of course, the civil power took that over, and propaganda has a different kind of smell to it there. But normally when you spoke of missions, you were talking about the Christian areas of the world going out to the ones who hadn't heard about Christianity, bringing the gospel to them, teaching them. So it was really foreign missions. But what we have here now with Kelly and his dream is, by the way, the United States at that point, PEI, was still under the Congregation of the Propaganda, among the other advantages that came from it. Small little areas couldn't set up their own seminaries and train their priests. There was a great international seminary in Rome, the Propaganda. And different areas had a quota. They could send 2, 3, 5 people. Our diocese sent people there. We had a quota of one or two, up to the last one, I think, came in 1910. We used to have a number of priests. We might have five, six, seven at any time who had had the Roman experience. And there were legal problems here. Bishops have the authority to run this. Now, who is going to, is every bishop going to send people out to unchurched areas? Or will all the bishops have to get together? And how does that fit into the Roman scheme? And so, we might take a break around now because, or do you need 5 minutes or something? We can wrap this part of it up. He had to go over and explain. It was his idea, and the bishops told him to go over and explain it. And he made the first of many, many trips to Rome. He became very familiar with it, and had to defend the idea, and he met the leaders, and eventually the whole idea was approved, and an extension, well, extension is a little different from it. This is one particular aspect. Who would send people out to the poor? If you're going to collect money and give it to them, you're going to need a machinery. You're going to need an agency. It itself would need a little operating fund, too. So that's what we get to around 1907. The Catholic Church Extension Society of the United States of America was founded in 1905, incorporated in Michigan that year. Kelly moved to the Archdiocese of Chicago in 1907. The extension received papal approval. That year, too, Kelly was awarded an honorary degree of Doctor of Laws by the University of Notre Dame, one of quite a number that he did receive later on. And we have finished the first part of his career, and we'll continue with it after the break. Thank you.
Let's take a 5 to 10 minute break, stretch your legs, and there's some sandwiches and some ginger snaps and some of my wife's famous gumdrop cake. We'll be making an appearance at the back table. So help yourself and grab a coffee or tea and come back to your seats, and we'll get started in about 5-10 minutes at the longest.
Oh, my.